going to tell you a story. It's about our bigger home, the universe. And it's about the force of gravity that shapes our universe more than any other force that we know. And yet, it is the least understood of all the forces of nature and presents the greatest challenge for those of us who are in search of the fundamental laws of nature. So very briefly and very quickly, I will take you from the time of Galileo to Newton to Maxwell, Einstein, and to the present day work in string theory. And let me just mention to you that we are all celebrating in the scientific world 100 years of Einstein's theory of general relativity this year. Galileo discovered a new law of nature which still holds. And you all know about this experiment from the Leaning Tower of Pisa, where he sort of took two objects, so one very heavy one and one light one, and let it go. And both of them actually, under good conditions of weather, basically hit the ground at the same time. So they fall in the same way, independent of their mass. That's a great law of nature. It's still valid to one part in 10 to the 10, actually, experimentally verified. So the next big step, actually, in the formulation of theory in science is, of course, Isaac Newton. And this is his famous law of gravitation, that how two masses, actually, two objects interact with each other. Force goes as the product of the masses, divided by the square of the distance by which they are separated. And you notice that this force is actually very weak, because I'm not really attracted to any one of you. I'm not falling towards you, right? It's very weak. But when the distance between the two objects becomes very, very small, you see this force is huge, okay, and uncontrolled. And in fact, in a sense, defines the rest of our story, okay? But it is also very large when the masses are very huge, you see. And the important thing is that this force cannot be screened like the force of electromagnetism, because charges come in different signs. I put plus charge, minus charge together, it's neutral, no force outside. But here, gravity cannot be screened. And this is the reason why it is really the dominant force of nature that shapes the large scale structure of our universe, okay? The force between objects actually acts instantaneously. Okay, so what this means is the following, that if I have two objects, if I shift this, you know, it just happens together. It's not that I do something here and then this responds. That's the way it should be, as we will see. But Newton's law of gravitation has one fundamental defect, that it is instantaneous. Means if some object moves, instantaneously something else moves, which means that the interaction is actually transmitted almost at infinite speed. 200 years later, approximately, Maxwell completed the theory of electromagnetism, and he unified it with what used to be called optics. He showed that light is actually a form of an electromagnetic wave, which travels at a fixed but very high speed. The important thing is that its speed is not infinite. It is finite, but it's very large. That is why in most of our daily lives, we feel that things happen instantaneously. This great discovery of Maxwell in the 19th century had a profound impact about 50 years later in the postulation of the special theory of relativity in 1905 by Albert Einstein. And leaving aside all the details, I'll just tell you in a sentence what the main impact of the theory of special relativity is, that it actually overthrew the idea of simultaneity. What does that mean? It means that if I have, for example, some rod here with two light bulbs, and I switch them and they're connected, so the bulbs will go on together, right? This is a simultaneous event for me. However, if you are actually moving with respect to me at a very high speed, you know, nearly, let's say, the speed of light or half the speed of light, it won't be simultaneous for you. So simultaneity is not universal. That means what is simultaneous for me or instantaneous is not instantaneous for somebody who is moving with respect to me, and you will detect it experimentally only if your speed, mover's speed, is very, very high. So simultaneity overthrown. Then Einstein thought there must be a problem with Newton's law of gravitation, as I mentioned to you, because it is instantaneous. And this led to this incredible search by Einstein to develop a law of gravity, actually, which reduces to Newton's law when, for, you know, earthly things like the ones we observe or even our planets, but which actually is the true theory. And that is the general theory of relativity that was put forward by him in 1915, 100 years ago. And I want to explain to you actually what this theory is. It is really one of the great creations of the human mind. And here it goes. Okay. So Einstein actually thought of gravity as no gravity. There is no gravity. Actually, what is there is that a big lump of matter basically distorts the fabric of space-time. Just imagine this trampoline over here. You know, there's a fabric that makes it. You put a big ball on it, it distorts the fabric of the trampoline, distorts the fabric of space-time. And that small little thing, you know, responds to that distortion, okay? Just like in a trampoline, take a ping pong ball and just leave it. It'll just go towards down. Or if you hit it, it'll take a circular motion. That's exactly what it is. So in fact, this cartoon actually is a real representation of what the solution of the equations of general relativity is. Okay? Now, even coming closer to what we understand, let me make an analogy for you, which is a very, there's more to what I'm saying now than meets the eye, but that's too technical for me to sort of go into. Okay? So imagine that you are actually in a nice place with a very beautiful lake, which is very calm, and you throw a stone in it, okay? You throw a stone and it disturbs the water. There are ripples that move out, and these ripples travel at a fixed speed, and that is the speed of sound in water, okay? And after a while, they sort of jiggle something else which is on their way. So suppose you had a piece of wood a little distance away, the wood will feel, you know, the water passing by. So the key point here is that there is a cause and an effect, and the cause and effect is communicated by a wave which is traveling at a fixed speed. The speed is not infinite. So nothing is instantaneous. Everything has a cause and effect, and it's communicated actually, okay? All right. So now you see, if I go back, you understand what I was saying very easily, because you can relate to this simple experiment. So now that I have given you this analogy with water, you all know that you know, water is the daily experience. Water is a smooth object, right? You don't really feel that there are molecules that make it up, right? I mean, you don't really experience the molecules. They can be seen in terms of very, very powerful microscopes, you know, which can resolve distances to distances of the order of an angstrom, or 10 to the minus 8 centimeters or something. But 100 years ago, nobody knew this actually. But yet, now we know that water has a structure, it has a molecular structure, it has phases, all types of things. So if the analogy with space-time and the fabric of space-time is right, it is right. There's an obvious question: what is the hidden structure underlying the geometry of space-time, which was smooth? What is the hidden structure? Is there something below it that we are not seeing, not experiencing, but which actually holds the whole thing together? Because if you look at just the equations of ordinary fluids or of water, those equations fail when you go to very short distances. Just like Newton's laws and the theory of general relativity really fails if you go to very, very small distances. So this granularity we are after of space-time, okay? So the question is very well posed. And I think it's one of the great achievements of the subject of string theory, which is going on for the last three decades now, almost. that it has succeeded in, at least in theory, telling you about what are the atoms of space-time, what is the granular structure below this very smooth space-time that we all actually experience. The clue lies in the study of black holes in string theory. So now, what is a black hole? A black hole is it's a solution of Einstein's equation, so it's consistent with Einstein's equations. It is also known now today that they exist in nature. So the theory of general relativity had the prediction and can explain objects in the sky. So what better a laboratory than to understand the granular structure of space-time in terms of black holes? So I have to tell you what a black hole is, okay? You see Schwarzschild, who actually first found the solution, and you see Subramaniam Chandrasekhar, who predicted the existence of such objects in the physics of collapsing stars. Okay. So a black hole is a, you know, it's a space-time object. You just imagine the sun, okay? Take the sun, it's a huge object. It has a mass of 10 to the 33 grams or something. It's a huge number. And shrink it to 3 kilometers, okay? That's a very compact object. That is a black hole. That the sun would become a black hole if you compress all its mass into a radius of approximately 3 kilometers. A black hole has a very peculiar feature, that it has a surface called the horizon. It's a one-way gate. If you fall in, you can't get out. If light falls in, it cannot get out. That's why it's called black. And it falls into the singularity. We don't worry about the singularity. That's a different issue, actually, okay? All right. So this is the black hole. This is our laboratory. Now let's pause. Something very, very important happened in the early part of the 20th century. A new mechanics was discovered. It's called quantum mechanics. And while it is true that the general theory of relativity has very few practical applications, except setting your GPS very accurately, that's the only application I can tell you about. Quantum mechanics has applications which are totally ubiquitous. I mean, everything that is working in this room, you know, all the electronics, all the computers, everything works on quantum mechanics. The laws of nature are different, actually, when you approach the system to be very, very small, like atoms, electrons, molecules. But when lots of them come together, then you can apply classical mechanics of Newton. One of the great discoveries of general relativity in the second half of the 20th century is the discovery by Hawking of the fact that black holes are actually hot. They are hot and they are not really black. I will explain in the next slide. And they are hot, and I have just listed a few temperatures. And we know that hot bodies have energy in the form of heat, which is measured by a quantity called entropy. And they calculated a very famous formula, which is the Bekenstein-Hawking formula, which says that the entropy of a black hole is simply proportional to the area of the horizon, that surface I mentioned to you. Okay, so that's one result that comes from general relativity, from the smooth description of space-time. There's another problem with black holes, that they are not really black because they radiate. And as I told you, that if you have a black hole of approximately 10 to the 18 grams, it's very, very hot. It's like 7,000 degrees Kelvin, which means it's like a white hole, really. And so these properties of black holes, quantum mechanics and relativity, creates a paradox, actually, a contradiction. And that contradiction is called information loss. And the idea is very simple, that a black hole forms by whatever you throw into it, chairs, Shakespeare, Milton, Bible, whatever. But it always evaporates in the same way, by Hawking radiation. So there is information loss. And what I think physicists have figured out in the last 100 years is there is a way of dealing with information loss, which is by statistical methods. And there's always some information loss when you average a system of many degrees of freedom. And this was basically understood by Boltzmann and others. And you get what is called the Boltzmann formula for the entropy. Now, if this formula for the entropy in terms of counting the atoms of space-time agrees with the formula of Hawking and Bekenstein, I think we have made great progress. because we have shown that what comes out of the smooth structure can be explained in terms of the underlying granular structure of space-time. The answer is yes, there are atoms of space-time, they are called brains, they are the analogues of the molecules of water, okay. Now I cannot explain to you what these objects are, okay, that's another discussion. But believe me that these are mathematically precisely understood atoms of space-time which are called brains. And you use this microscopic understanding of black holes and model the system, okay. So there are lots and lots of people who have worked on this, and a lot of people from India actually who have made good contributions to this subject. So if you compute the temperature and entropy of a class of black holes, then it agrees on the dot with the formula of Hawking and Bekenstein. That's a great achievement, and that was done by Strominger and Waffa, which set forth the entire development in this subject about 15 to 20 years ago. So then you can calculate Hawking radiation. That also agrees with Hawking's calculation. Then you can make more precise this fluid dynamics analogy I gave you. And that has to do with something called the fact that gravity is holographic. Basically, what happens in space-time is coded on the surface of that space-time, okay? Like a hologram, okay? And what is the most important thing is that with these structures that we know, we can make finite calculations in quantum gravity and really put forth the theory of gravitation, which was not really available to Einstein. So I think let me just tell you one last thing is that this type of idea of searching for a way, indirect way of understanding the granular nature of matter was actually employed by Einstein and Perrin much before we actually knew really about the existence of atoms. And the epilogue is that smooth space-time of our experience is an approximate description of the underlying structure that is needed for a complete theory of gravity. And this is the subject of intense research today in a lot of us at the Tata Institute in Mumbai and Bangalore and other places in India are really very much involved in this. Thank you for your attention.